Filipino-Americans were among those affected by Hurricane Milton. ABS-CBN's North America Bureau is keeping tabs on their situation. Our correspondent, Henny Espinosa, filed this report.
Hey guys, here are news-making headlines for Filipinos in North America.
We begin with Hurricane Milton zipping into the Atlantic Ocean on Thursday after hitting Florida Wednesday evening, killing at least 10 people and wreaking havoc in many communities still reeling from the impact of Hurricane Helene a couple of weeks ago. Some 3.4 million people lost power as of Thursday afternoon, on top of the 700,000 that were restored since the storm. Milton made landfall as a Category 3 storm near Siesta Key, a barrier island next to Sarasota, with winds in excess of 100 miles per hour.
The storm did bring much destruction and damage. Tornadoes ravaged parts of the east coast of the state. Flooding occurred on the west and east coast, and strong winds lashed the state, especially in Pinellas, Hillsborough, Manatee, and Sarasota counties.
DeSantis says while the storm was significant, it was not the worst case scenario.
Yeah, the storm did weaken before landfall, and the storm surge, as initially reported, has not been as significant overall as what was observed for Hurricane Helene.
Still, Milton's wrath could be felt across the state. Some 11 million people are at risk of flash and river flooding. Search and rescue operations by more than 1,400 teams are ongoing. Because of Hurricane Milton, over 5.5 million people were urged to leave Florida's western coast in one of the largest evacuations in state history. More than 80,000 people had stayed in shelters, but some Philams living in areas where the eye of the storm was decided to shelter in place.
It felt like the house was going to take off, and the noises were like something out of a horror movie. It was a mashup of Twister and then The Conjuring. In my opinion, it was a total nightmare.
Flores says Milton struck down trees and damaged some houses in the neighborhood.
I'd say it's minor damage in my immediate area, but it's hard to really assess because we're advised not to go out except around our homes. It is important to let our first responders do their work, because many fatalities happen after the hurricane when people aren't careful.
Sheila Legaspi, a resident of Bradenton, shared with ABS-CBN News images of Milton's impact on her neighborhood. She also sheltered in place.
Right now, as you can see behind me here, houses are still boarded. And you can hear all the generators and a chainsaw clearing from the debris that was scattered all over our community. Most houses here sustained very minimal damages compared to other areas.
These stunning images were captured by Dennis Uy Brillantes in Palm Beach County as he was headed home on Wednesday.
I see this big funnel spinning and almost like dancing. I pulled over, watched it. It was very mesmerizing and scary at the same time.
Brillante says it was the first time he saw a tornado that close.
It was getting bigger and bigger, and I realized that it was getting closer and closer. And at that time, a cop pulled behind me and told me to move. So I did move and realized that it was headed actually to where we live.
Brillantes raced home and was relieved his wife and son and their home were safe. On Wednesday, when Milton struck, there were 38 tornado reports, with over 125 issued tornado warnings across Florida, the most tornado warnings ever in a single day for the Sunshine State. Some tornadoes were supercharged, such as the ones in St. Lucie County, where five people were killed.
And those are the news-making headlines today. You can catch more TFC News on the ABS-CBN News website, YouTube channel, and app. I'm Henny Espinosa. Back to you guys at the Rundown.
The White House confirms at least 10 deaths from Hurricane Milton. U.S. Homeland Security Secretary Alejandro Mayorkas says most of them were likely killed by tornadoes. He also gives his assurance government is capable of responding to multiple disasters.
It is imperative that everyone continues to follow the direction of local officials. Milton may have passed, but the danger it poses has not. Downed power lines, flood waters, non-potable drinking water, and debris are creating deadly conditions. But I want to be clear, we have the capability and the capacity to respond to and recover from multiple simultaneous disasters. No resources needed for Hurricane Helene response will be diverted to respond to Hurricane Milton.
Over in the U.S., President Joe Biden is urging Congress to go back to work and address disaster relief funding needs in the aftermath of Hurricane Milton. The U.S. Congress is currently on recess, and lawmakers are not scheduled to return to Washington until after the November 5 election. Biden says emergency needs of storm victims should be taken care of immediately.
This is a whole-of-government effort. It also includes the Department of Energy, Department of Transportation, Department of Health and Human Services, and the Department of Housing and Urban Development, which is providing mortgage relief for impacted homeowners. As directed, FEMA is going to open disaster recovery centers all across the impacted communities right away. I think Congress should move as rapidly as they can, particularly on the most immediate need, which is small business.
Biden also shielding the federal government's response from misinformation being spread by the Republican Party. Donald Trump earlier made a false claim aid is being turned away from storm victims and towards migrants.
All the things, that $750 that you're talking about, but Mr. Trump and all those other people know it's a lie to suggest that's all they're going to get. That's bizarre. It's bizarre. They got to stop this. They're being so damn un-American with the way they're talking about this stuff. But there's going to be a need for significant amounts of money. We're already underway at trying to calculate what the cost will be because we don't want to mislead anybody. We want to make sure all the costs are able to be covered. Former President Trump, get a life, man. Help these people.
Turning now to the crisis in the Middle East, at least 18 people are killed and more than 90 others injured in the latest Israeli strikes on Beirut. A Lebanese security source says at least one senior Hezbollah figure was targeted in the attacks, whose identity remains unclear. The neighborhood was not previously hit by Israel and is well removed from Beirut's southern suburbs, the headquarters of the Iran-backed group. Earlier in the day, Israel warned Lebanese civilians not to return to homes in the south to avoid being caught in the crossfire. UN peacekeepers determined to remain in their posts in southern Lebanon despite orders by Israel's advancing military to leave. Israeli attacks on Wednesday and Thursday injured two members of the peacekeeping force and knocked out some of their monitoring capabilities. Israel said its troops operated near a UNIFIL base, but it had instructed the UN forces in the area to remain in protected spaces before opening fire. The UN peacekeeping chief says the security and safety of their peacekeepers in Lebanon are increasingly in jeopardy, and operational activities have virtually come to a halt.
Peacekeepers have been confined to their bases with significant periods of time in shelter. This severe impediment to the mission's freedom of movement within the area of operation has limited the mission's monitoring and reporting ability. The security environment has also presented challenges for the resupply of fuel, food, and water for UN positions. The deconfliction of UNIFIL logistics movements remains paramount.
UNIFIL is mandated by a Security Council resolution to help the Lebanese army keep the country's south free of weapons and armed personnel other than those of the state. A South Korean author wins the Nobel Prize in Literature for the first time. Han Kang was recognized by the Swedish Academy for her intense poetic prose that confronts historical traumas and exposes the fragility of human life. Han began her career in 1993 with the publication of a number of poems in the magazine Literature and Society, while her prose debut came in 1995 with the short story collection Love of Yu Su. Her major international breakthrough came with the novel The Vegetarian, which was turned into a movie in 2009 and translated into English in 2016. Netflix offers fans the chance to buy an array of memorabilia from its shows in a pop-up shop opening in two British cities. Appropriately titled, as seen on Netflix, on sale are a range of wardrobe pieces and props from hit shows such as The Crown, Bridgerton, Black Mirror, and Sex Education. Prices for some of the items start at just £1. And it's all for a good cause, as well as proceeds will go to Mind, a British mental health charity.
We wanted this to feel like something that all fans can come to, have a look around, have a great experience when they're in here, and then take something home. So it starts at £1 all the way up to higher ticket items. But there is something in these stores that you can afford, which was the real goal for this.
As seen on Netflix, will open in London this Saturday and Birmingham on October 19. Select pieces will also be available through an online auction from the 11th to the 21st.